Harper Audio presents Don't Get Scrooged, How to Thrive in a World Full of Obnoxious, Incompetent, Arrogant, and Downright Mean-Spirited People. Written and read by Richard Carlson. Copyright 2006 by Richard Carlson. Production copyright 2006 by HarperCollins Publishers. Introduction. Tis the season, and items on your to-do list are multiplying daily. Trees to trim, cookies to bake, gifts to buy, and wrap, and mail, and deliver. People to see, places to be, pounds to gain. Whether you're driving or flying, going to the office party or hosting one of your own, entering the mall again, or feeling mauled by traffic, you are not alone. Everyone, it seems, is doing the same things you are, exponentially upping the odds of not just getting jostled, but getting Scrooged. It's as though we are all being dogged by descendants of Ebenezer Scrooge, Charles Dickens' Christmas Carol character who left everyone he encountered, at work, on the street, in his family, with something to grumble about. Not that having a bone to pick with humanity is purely a seasonal ritual. Any day of the year can be, and sometimes is, just a bad day. As I drove to my office today, I stopped as usual at my favorite coffee shop for my favorite coffee drink. While waiting in line, I overheard three separate conversations, all of which featured people complaining about other people in their lives who were, in one way or another, driving them crazy. Last night, as I was flying home from a trip, everyone around me seemed to be having the same type of conversation, including the flight attendants. I'd bet the pilots were in the cockpit kvetching, too. The details are always different, but the gist of the conversations is much the same. Someone is bent out of shape by someone else's incompetence, arrogance, or obnoxious, mean-spirited behavior. Restaurants, airports, family gatherings, parties, seminars, work-related get-togethers, grocery store lines, sporting events, elevators, bars, hotel lobbies, wherever you are, the background whine is there. I visited a friend in the hospital recently, and nearly everyone in the waiting room was griping about someone. The staff, the doctor, the sick family member, the other family members who weren't there, the DSL carrier, you name it. Virtually everyone, except perhaps the Dalai Lama, seems to be preoccupied with Scrooges. Although airing your grievances with others may help you feel less alone and on rare occasion get you good advice, more often than not, it keeps you stuck in a bad mood. While recounting every detail of the offending person's behavior, it's hard not to get riled up and feel the slight all over again. Our feelings are a reflection of where our attention lies. And if you are focusing on getting your listener to understand just how bad this other person has behaved, your energy is clearly on the misdeeds in question. It's hard to feel calm and happy when witty retorts have finally occurred to you and visions of revenge are dancing through your head. What's more, time spent complaining is not time spent improving, letting go of, or preventing bad situations. It is sad to say, but griping does not accomplish a darn thing. If venting to any and all who will listen doesn't do much good, what does? I'm going to show you some practical ways to deal with selfish, obnoxious, unethical, greedy, needy, mean people. I call them turkeys. You can call them whatever you like. But as you listen, my real hope is that you'll find it easy to eliminate much of your complaining. I can't wave a wand and ensure that you'll no longer have anything to complain about, but I can give you a few, make that 50, better things to do. Most of the strategies offered here are simple, but some might take practice to master. All of us have the bottom line goal of keeping a smile on our face no matter what comes our way. This may sound like an impossible dream, but I found that it really is possible. I've developed these tools because life is challenging enough without giving the most irritating people in it power over our well-being. A huge part of feeling Scrooged is feeling powerless. How'd that happen? Why'd they do that? But each of us has a vast reservoir of largely untapped power. We can change the way we look at, perceive, think about, and respond to virtually anyone. P.S. Scrooges hate this. All the more reason to keep listening. It's not Daytona. You're not Jeff Gordon. Don't try to cook tailgating turkeys. Here they are, another set of holidays, another set of packed roads and parking lots, long drives to family gatherings in bad weather, and impromptu trips to the market when your cocktail party runs out of cocktail weenies. Holidays mean hitting highways, and highways and roads can be unbearably jammed from Thanksgiving to whenever the last New Year's Day partier straggles home. There is a stocking full of reasons the most wonderful time of the year can put us on the road and in a rage. The holidays should probably come with a don't drive or operate heavy machinery warning label. Anyone who's ever had an unfortunate encounter with an automobile knows they can do a lot of damage, especially when the people driving them just had a few drinks at their office party or recently went to 4 toy stores looking for the only item their 7-year-old has asked Santa for, or have blocked their rearview mirror's view with a big fat box. Sharing the road with these drivers, I know you'd actually never be one of them, can be scary and challenging in normal circumstances, let alone when you're feeling hurried and harried, overbooked and overwhelmed. Our highest priority when strapped into metal and glass boxes traveling at high speeds is safety, not being right, not getting there first, and not teaching other people how to drive. So when someone's tailgating you, or you're navigating a 4-way stop, or another driver near you is having trouble staying between the white lines, the safest thing to do is yield. Too many people play games with tailgaters, slamming on the brakes, letting them pass, and then showing them how it feels by riding their bumper. But this is no game. It is life or death. So yield, change lanes, pull over, and call the police if you're really that heated. I mean this advice literally and figuratively. In case my symbolism isn't crystal clear, the preceding rules apply to the road of life as well as the road of, well, you know, the road. Giving turkeys a wide berth is often the fastest and safest way to arrive safely at your destination. You may feel momentarily Scrooged, but at least you won't have scars and stitches in this year's holiday photo. So here are your keys. Enjoy the holidays. Take a vacation, not a guilt trip. Don't get shit upon. They are so sneaky. I'm talking about those insidious Scrooges who present themselves as quiet, soft, concerned, and on the surface, kind. They are the guilt trippers, the people who, with a simple, "Have you visited Joan?" or a quiet, "I can't because I'm volunteering that day," make you feel guilty, persuade you to do what you don't want to do, and let you know that you should be doing something else or something more. Ugh. I just said that these people can make you feel, even though I tend to avoid that phrase because I think it's important that we take responsibility for our own feelings and do as much as we can to avoid victim think. But gosh darn it, guilt trippers are so good at what they do that it's hard not to feel jerked around by them. One reason they can so easily push our buttons is that often some tiny, deep-down part of us does wonder if we should be visiting Joan or volunteering at the soup kitchen, especially if we're playing tennis or going to a matinee instead. We all know that self-doubts are a part of everyday life. So let's say you are up against a fully conscious, stone-cold, semi-professional manipulator. When I'm in this position, I sometimes think of a bumper sticker I once saw. I will not should on myself today. You might even try saying it aloud, with a smile on your face, to the person making you feel like crap. Last year, my family vacationed with two other families. I quickly realized that there was a guilt tripper on this getaway. Everyone in his family seemed to easily agree on what they'd do and when, except for Bill. I repeatedly overheard him pressuring his wife, sister, and kids to do the things he wanted to do by making it seem like they were things they should all want to do. Now, this was Bill's vacation too, so he had every right to want to enjoy himself. But it was the approach he used to try to get his way. He didn't just say, "Gosh, I'm really interested in taking this tour. Any takers?" He whined. "I know you've all been there, but wouldn't it be great to be there together? This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Okay, I guess I'll just never get to see it." Bill tried to make others feel sorry for him and guilty for depriving him. He did this to the point where they might not have been able to enjoy themselves unless they gave in. Then I heard a beautiful thing. Bill's sister Judy said, "Bill, you're acting obnoxious. We're all tired of being pushed around. We're going to do our own thing. You're welcome to join us if you can go with the flow and stop bugging us. If not, please just go and do your own thing. We all love you, but none of us want you around if you're going to continue to act like a 3-year-old who isn't getting his way." Consider the alternative. The family could have caved, had a lousy day, and resented old Bill. This way, they didn't get their vacation Scrooged, and Bill had the opportunity to meet his own needs and learn a little something about his behavior. Shoulds happen, but you can send guilt trippers packing. Guest room Grinches, putting house guests from hell on best behavior. During the holidays, people travel from near and far to visit with the family and friends dearest to them. It's such a lovely portrait, everyone gathered at your house eating, drinking, and reminiscing, while crammed together under one roof, with the weather so bad you can't leave the house, and you're sleeping, well, kind of, on the sofa so mom can have the bed. And by day two, you're all sick of each other and the recycled, semi-sincere conversations. Is it a Hallmark moment or the longest week of your life? One thing that can tip the scales against a good experience is having guests who are, well, pigs. Whether they're visiting for an hour or a week, whether they're 6 months old or 60 years, blood relations or relative unknowns, if they leave wet towels on the bathroom floor and crumb trails, they can make you want to roll up the welcome mat and turn off the porch light. House guests from hell don't make themselves at home. They make themselves on vacation, at a 5-star hotel where they seem to assume that maid service occurs twice daily and all the meals are included. Alas, home invasions can take place year-round. Perhaps you play concierge during the summer months because you live near the beach. Whatever the season, it's time to reclaim your home, sweet home. The best way to do this is to make some rules and stick to them. Do this in the way that best suits your personality, but do it. I know folks who have written up a playful list of do's. Please help yourself to complimentary coffee and pastry whenever you get up. And don'ts. Please don't leave dishes in the sink. Framed it and hung it on the back of their guest room door, just like at a Motel 6. The point is that you can't expect people to read your mind. Stewing about how so-and-so really should know such-and-such without your having to mention it is fruitless. As Dr. Phil would say, "How's that working for you?" So make it playful or serious, do it in print or in person, but one way or another, speak up. When you're planning a get-together at your home, pipe up about what you want and need. If people are used to you doing all the cooking, but you've had a really tough week, month, or year, let them know that you are thinking potluck. Could you please bring that wonderful stuffing you make? Or tell your guests that takeout is the plan this time around. Let them know that, because of your allergies, they just can't bring their dog this time. Since they probably can't kennel their Hell on Wheels 3-year-old, make a plan to contain the chaos in one child-proofed rec room. You might also try to silence your inner Martha and get over all notions of perfection. Paper plates diminish cleanup and increase the odds that your wedding china will survive until your next anniversary. And if you're debating whether to go with store-bought food or home-baked, remember this. If it gives you less time in the cooking room and more time in the living room, it's a good thing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.